Marxism and Freedom by Raya Dunayevskaya, Chapter 10, The Collapse of the Second International and the Break in Lenin's Thought. The Holocaust of World War I, erupting after a century of near peace and general optimism, shook the world to its foundations. It brought about the fall of the world socialist organization known as the Second International. The German social democracy had voted war credits to the Kaiser. So incredible did this appear, so completely unexpected, that the Vorwärts, which announced this fact, was thought by Lenin to be a forgery of the German Imperial Office. When it was proved to be true, the theoretical ground on which he had stood, and which he had thought so impregnable, gave way under him. Prior to August 1914, all Marxists agreed that material conditions create the basis for the creation of a new society, that the more advanced the material conditions, the better prepared the proletariat would be for taking power. Now, these same mass labor parties in the most advanced countries, where technology was most fully developed and the proletariat most highly organized, took an action which hurled masses of workers across national boundaries to slaughter each other in defense of the fatherland. Germany was only the first. The Marxists of the other warring European countries soon followed suit. The German social democracy was not an organization of bourgeois liberals or of deviating reformists. It was, in the main, an organization of avowed revolutionary Marxists. Before the outbreak of war, they had taken an unambiguous stand against any imperialist war that might break out. The war no sooner broke out than they were part of that mobilization for destruction. Why? They betrayed, yes, but betrayal wasn't merely selling out. What were the objective causes for such total ideological collapse? The fact was overwhelming, totally unforeseen, incontrovertible. Confronted with the appearance of counter-revolution within the revolutionary movement, Lenin was driven to search for a philosophy that would reconstitute his own reason. He began reading Hegel's Science of Logic. It formed the philosophic foundation for the Great Divide in Marxism. His philosophic notebooks show how completely he reorganized his conception of the relationship between the materialistic or economic forces and the human subjective forces, the relationship between science and human activity. 1. Lenin and the Dialectic, a Mind in Action. All revolutions in the sciences, no less than in general history, originate only in this, that the spirit of man, for the understanding and comprehension of himself, for the possessing of himself, has now altered his categories, uniting himself in a truer, deeper, more intrinsic relation with himself. That was a quote from Hegel. Krupskaya, Lenin's wife and closest collaborator, in her Memories of Lenin, tells us that Lenin began his study of Hegel for the Essay on Marxism, commissioned by the Encyclopedia Granat. He thereupon placed the philosophical question in the forefront, as is evident from the first section of the essay. She adds, "This was not the usual way of presenting Marxist teaching. This is true, scores of popularizations of Marxism or Marxian economics had been written. Lenin's essay is the first, since the death of Marx and Engels, to show the primacy of a philosophical approach. There is no doubt that as soon as Lenin opened the Science of Logic, he grasped the importance of dialectics, the movement of thought. Movement and self-movement. Change, movement, and life. the principle of every self-movement, impulse to movement and to activity, opposite a dead being, who would believe that this is the core of Hegelianism, of abstract and abstruse Hegelianism? We must disclose this core, grasp it, save, shell it out, purify it, which is precisely what Marx and Engels have done. When Lenin began his study of Hegel, as his philosophic notebooks show, he still felt compelled to emphasize that he is reading Hegel materialistically. Instead of taking that for granted and going on to what was new, by the end of the Hegelian studies, he wrote, "Intelligent idealism is nearer to intelligent materialism than is stupid materialism. Dialectic idealism, instead of intelligent, metaphysical, undeveloped, dead, vulgar, stationary, instead of stupid." But his characteristic precision, Lenin himself, or with his characteristic precision, Lenin himself tells when he first fully grasped the dialectic. He wrote the essay on Marxism between July and November 1914, the period when he began his study of the larger logic. On January 4th, 1915, having already forwarded the essay to the Encyclopedia Granat, he wrote, "By the way, will there not still be time for certain corrections in the section on dialectics? Perhaps you will be good enough to write and say when exactly it is to go to the printers and what the last date is for receiving corrections. I have been studying this question of dialectics for the last month and a half, and I think I could add something to it if there was time." 6 weeks, that is the time it took him to reach the book on subjectivity and the doctrine of the notion. The notebooks carry the date December 17th, 1914. It is under the section on syllogisms, where Hegel destroys the opposition between subjectivity and objectivity, that Lenin bursts forth with the aphorisms that reveal how decisive was his break with his own philosophic past. Heretofore, to Lenin, as to everybody else in the Second International, the Hegelian dialectic had been important, mainly as a reference point in internal polemics. If an opponent was obscure, he was accused of dialectical sophistry and reminded that Marx had turned Hegel around and stood him right side up. Reformist and evolutionary theorists of socialist development were fought by citing Hegel's dialectic. It was generally agreed that Hegel stood for development and revolution, rather than standing still and evolution. The conception of contradiction was that of two units existing alongside of one another. The conception of opposition had not gone beyond Kant's dualism, as if Hegel had never destroyed it with the conception that every single thing is itself a contradiction, is the basis of all movement. Hence, that all movement is self-movement. Having broken with this philosophic past, Lenin now moved boldly to sum up the essence of the dialectic. Briefly, the dialectic can be defined as the doctrine of the unity of opposites. Thereby is the kernel of the dialectic grasped, but that demands explanation and development. For the first time, he was no longer satisfied with Hilferding's Finance Capital, the standard accepted study of the latest stage of capitalist development. He embarked on an independent analysis. His voluminous notebooks, filling 693 pages, were his preparation for the small volume that was published as Imperialism. These preparatory notes show how, in the concrete economic study, he holds tight to the dialectic. The published work itself was a demonstration in economics of the dialectic as the unity of opposites. Prior to 1914, Marxists had treated cartels, trusts, syndicates as mere forms of large-scale production, as part of a continuous development of capitalism. Capitalism seemed to be organizing the economy, removing planlessness, and thus making it easier for the workers to take over, as if it were merely a matter of replacing one set of office holders with another. Now, however, Lenin treats monopoly not so much as a part of a continuous development, but as a development through contradiction, through transformation into opposite. Competition was transformed into its opposite, monopoly. But monopoly didn't transcend competition. It coexists with it. It multiplies contradictions. It deepens the crisis. Imperialism arose not out of capitalism in general, but out of capitalism at a specific stage, when its essential qualities became transformed into their opposites. Just as competition was transformed into its opposite, monopoly. A party of the proletariat was transformed into its opposite, the aristocracy of labor. That was the bulwark of the Second International that caused its collapse. Lenin's study of monopoly capitalism followed his philosophic notebooks, and outside of that context cannot be fully understood. Once Lenin saw the counter-revolution within the revolutionary movement, he felt compelled to break with his former conception of the relationship between materialism and idealism. The keynote of his philosophic notebooks is nothing short of restoration of truth to philosophic idealism against vulgar materialism, to which he had given the green light in 1908 with his work on materialism and imperial criticism. Necessary as that book may have been for the specific purposes of Russia, only Russia was so backward that in 1908 one still had to fight clericalism in the Marxist movement. He now includes himself among the Marxists who criticize the Kantians, more in a Feuerbachian than in a Hegelian manner. Of his former teacher, Plekhanov, respected as such, Lenin now writes, Plekhanov wrote on philosophy, dialectic, probably nearly 1,000 pages. There is nil in them about the larger logic, about it, its thoughts, i.e. the dialectic proper, as a philosophic science. Nil. With himself, he is as merciless, giving no quarter, not even in the economic field. It is impossible completely to grasp Marx's Capital, and especially its first chapter, if you have not studied through and understood the whole of Hegel's logic. Consequently, none of the Marxists for the past half a century have understood Marx. Before 1914, Lenin had one view of capital and philosophy. War and the collapse of the Second International made him turn to the dialectic and changed his views. But he didn't face either event with a blank mind. He had been a practicing revolutionary in Russia and was molded by the sharpness of the contradictions of that backward country. There is no study of Volume 2 of Capital more profound than that which Lenin had made at the turn of the century. There is no more profound grasp of the dialectic in action, that is to say, masses as reason, than that which he made of the 1905 revolution. No matter where Lenin resided, however, he lived in Russia. He was a Russian Marxist. He was unprepared for the International's collapse, but having faced it both in actuality and in philosophy, he became politically more irreconcilable than ever. It was not a mood. His attitude was not only against those who betrayed. The collapse of the Second International meant the breakdown of all previous thought and method of thought which called itself Marxist, i.e. all established Marxism. 2. The Irish Revolution and the dialectic of history. There is no major work of Lenin's, from the philosophic notebooks until his death, that is not permeated with the dialectic. It is the very warp and woof of all his works, from imperialism to the split in the International, from the national question to state and revolution, from the famous trade union debate to his will. It is in the will that Lenin says he thinks Bukharin never quite grasped the dialectic, and therefore cannot be considered fully a Marxist. Thus we see that the great divide in Marxism that set an unbridgeable gulf between the Second International and the tendency that would become the new Third International did not exhaust itself there. On the contrary, the new philosophic foundations already contained in germ the next division of Marxism. for this is the battle of reason, and if one hasn't changed his method of thought, he can be sure to collapse at the next great crisis. The supreme example of that during the war was one who would become a leader of the Russian Revolution, Nikolai Bukharin. The question was that of self-determination of nations, on which Lenin suddenly found himself isolated, even among the Bolsheviks. Prior to World War I, there was no difference among the Bolsheviks in the question of the self-determination of nations. All agreed to the liberation of nations in principle, but where, with the outbreak of war, Lenin saw a new urgency in the question, Bukharin elaborated an entirely new thesis. The imperialist epoch is an epoch of the absorption of small states, he wrote. It is therefore impossible to struggle against the enslavement of nations otherwise than by struggling against imperialism, ergo against capitalism in general. Any deviation from that road, any advancement of partial tasks of the liberation of nations within the realm of capitalist civilization means diverting of proletarian forces from the actual solution of the problem. The slogan of self-determination is first of all utopian and harmful, as a slogan which disseminates illusions. And blaming the masses, he also wrote, the collapse of the Second International is recognized as a fact. This collapse is explained not so much by the treason of the leaders as by the objective causes of chauvinist conduct of the masses. Lenin called this nothing short of imperialist economism, saying it is clear Bukharin has permitted the war to suppress his thinking. The scornful attitude of imperialist economism toward democracy constitutes one of these forms of depression or suppression of human reasoning by the war. Lenin hit us hard against Bukharin's co-leader, Pyatakov. The real source of all his curious errors in logic is that his thinking has been depressed by the war, and because of this depression, the position of Marxism toward democracy in general has been basically distorted. It is true, Lenin continued, that capitalism in general and imperialism in particular transforms democracy into an illusion, but it at the same time generates democratic tendencies among masses. As opposed to Bukharin's and Pyatakov's counterposing the existence of imperialism and the non-existence of democracy, Lenin stressed the coexistence of imperialism and the democratic tendencies among the masses. On Easter Day, 1916, the Irish masses acted. The shortage of food which was being used for military needs, the threat to conscript Irishmen for service in the British Army, the heavy taxation, the jailing of thousands under the Defense of the Realm Act, all brought to a fever pitch the anger of the Irish people. The insurrection began with the proclaiming of the Irish Republic at the foot of Nelson's Column in Dublin. Detachments of Irish volunteers seized important positions throughout Dublin. The General Post Office, the park called St. Stephen's Green, the four courts, many bridges and rooftop vantage points. The military force was the Irish Volunteers, first organized in 1913 as an aftermath of the heroic strike of the Irish Transport Workers Union to defend its constitutional rights. At Jacob's factory, the poor workers of the district formed themselves as an unarmed human barrier around the factory, protecting their means of making a life from destruction by the British Army. Women and girls carried food and ammunition to the barricades, fought alongside their men, carried dispatches between points held by the rebels. The teenage girls, organized as Cumana Ban, the Boy Scouts, organized by Countess de Markievicz, were everywhere in the fighting and dispatch carrying. The worker and intellectual, the clergyman, the shopkeeper, and the manufacturer all were determined to rid themselves of British domination. As one journalist, Maurice Joy, wrote, there were no intellectual boundary lines. Poets wrote treatises on wireless telegraphy, and wireless telegraphers wrote dramas. Above all, there were no dilettantes among them. On the first day, the British were stunned by the activity and success of the Irish. The conduct of the Irish during these events was above reproach, as even the most bitter English enemy had to admit. There was no looting, rapine, or brutality. Rapine, raping, or brutality. Captives received the same treatment as those defending the barricades. The slogan of the men was, "'Tis better to have fought and lost than never to have fought at all." It not only delivered a powerful blow to the British Empire, it gave a signal to the world that man's struggle for freedom was not alone an ideological, but a material force. The revolt was not crushed until all forces were completely out of ammunition and isolated from all support. It raised a flame that would continue to burn until independence was finally won. Lenin hailed the rebellion and accepted it as the real test of his thesis. In summing up the discussion on self-determination, he concluded, "The dialectics of history is such that small nations, powerless as an independent factor in the struggle against imperialism, play part as one of the baculi, which help the real power against imperialism to come on the scene, namely the socialist proletariat. To imagine that social revolution is conceivable without revolts by small nations in the colonies and in Europe means repudiating social revolution." Bucharin was entirely blind to the fact that the dialectics of the revolution itself was at stake in the theoretical debate. Where he was looking for some integral picture of the collapse of imperialism and capitalism, Lenin was searching for new beginnings, which would determine the end. And he found these in two directions. One, the struggle of national groupings for independence. And two, the very stratification of the working class. Far from finding the working class as a class chauvinist, he was searching for lower and deeper strata in it to realize the creative energies of millions. If Hegelian phraseology may be permitted, what Lenin was saying to Bucharin was that he who does not see a new subject emerge out of a great crisis is compelled to run to the absolute, read socialism, like a bolt out of the blue, instead of living through the birth throes of an actually developing revolution or living history. Long ago, Marx had castigated the abstract materialists for not seeing the processes of history. Now Lenin became intolerant of the economist. The logic of self-determination in theory as in fact showed that just when there was the growing internationalization, i.e. imperialist suppression, that is when there was also the revolt. He was asking Bucharin to get away from causality to explain the relation between the ideal and the real, and instead to be where the notion of freedom and subjectivity are. That is to say, the free creative power of the masses. Thus, the great divide in Marxism was not alone with those who betrayed, but with those who, in thought, are near the dialectic, but never quite make it, and thus cannot be considered fully Marxist. The slightest slip off the dialectic of revolution, that is, the strictest relationship of the revolutionary activity of the mass to the specific economic epoch, and the Marxist theoretician ends by anticipating the next stage of bourgeois development. What Bucharin only theorized about, Stalin was ruthless enough to put into effect. We shall see when we deal with Stalin how prophetic Lenin was when he wrote, "The necessity of solidarity of forces against the international West, which defends the capitalist world, is one thing. It is another thing when we ourselves fall into something like imperialistic relations toward the oppressed nationalities." It remains the most devastating commentary on present-day Russia.